with the particular symptoms. After head, we will straight away start with the eye symptoms of cornea. Now again, as I keep telling you in many classes, that you know particulars, to understand particulars, you should know sphere of action, very important. You should know ailments from, and you should know the characteristic symptoms. If you know all the three, then particular symptoms become very easy. Now go back to the anatomy and understand the structure of the eye. And now you apply from the sphere of action, which part does cornea act? Can somebody quickly tell me what could be the probable action of corneum on eyes? You need to be a little quick so that you know we can. Yeah, very good. Somebody writes, Spurthi says inflammation. Okay. Anything beyond inflammation that you can think of? Or should I ask the question? Janaki says ulceration. Yeah, it depresses the nerve. Squint, very good. Squint. Photophobia, good. Okay. See, now more than inflammation, what you have to understand. Now go back to the action of corneum on corneum on eyes. Maya says ocular muscles, very good. Now what is the action of corneum on ocular muscles? Okay, what is the action of corneum on ocular muscles? Very good. Pratibha says paralysis. Yes, good, very important. See, rather than inflammation in corneum, you Salman again says paralysis, very good. So rather than inflammation in corneum, you see more of paralysis. So the ocular muscles, they go into paralysis. That's one part of cornea. Apart from paralysis, somebody rightly commented photophobia. Okay. See, when you type the word photophobia in your repertory, you'll have some 300 plus remedies coming up. Now, when exactly we indicate cornea, that's very important. Now, photophobia, again, if I ask you to recall, you might come out with a few more remedies. Now, what is the PQRS of photophobia in cornea? Now, photophobia can be for sunlight. Photophobia can be for the tube light. Okay. So, to make things very simple, photophobia for natural light and photophobia for artificial light. Corneum is a remedy. Generally, we think of in photophobia, which is mainly, I'll come to this point. Before I tell you this, there's a very important concomitant symptom associated in corneum. Photophobia associated with excessive lacrimation. So they have increased lacrimation and then they have photophobia. This combination, one can think of corneum. Now apart from this, a very important point in this particular remedy, photophobia for, yes, Swati, you know, many of your friends, they have rightly said, photophobia, which mainly comes from artificial light. This is very, very important. Okay. So, photophobia from artificial light. See, small remedies that you can think of here is euphrasia. Euphrasia is again a remedy which causes photophobia and which is more from artificial light. One more key point I would like to add here is, photophobia in corneum will be without inflammation, meaning you will not see any inflammatory pathology of the eye, but you will have photophobia. This is again very, very important. Okay. So photophobia, artificial light, photophobia associated with excessive lacrimation, photophobia without any inflammatory pathology of the eye. Now these statements, they're very important and that will signify a corneum acting on eye. Now, as many of you have rightly contributed, this is very important. What is it? If you just see this image here, you have the ocular muscles going into paralysis and this is the effect you see in corneum. Now, which are all the other remedies which can act on the ocular muscles and cause paralysis? Any other remedies that you can quickly recall from your second and third year remedies? Very good. Rachita, she says causticum, beautiful, absolute, very good. Priyanka, argentum nitricum, Like I said, it's beautiful. I'm happy. Lot of remedies coming in. Two very important remedies that should come to your mind as a third year student is gelsemium and causticum. Though you have lachesis, though you have argentum, though you also have alumina, from 26 to 30 remedies you have. But the top remedies will be gelsemium and argentum. Okay? So I hope this slide will tell you the action of conium on ice. I hope I am clear here. We'll move ahead. See, we are not going into the details of the ear, the nose and other areas. So we'll directly talk of the stomach. Again, in stomach, I am focusing mainly on the desires and aversions of conium. Okay? See, probably one area that we have missed and you can think of conium is face. What exactly can you think of in face conium? Do we see warts? Do we see anything else in conium? Max that you can see in conium is there can be facial paralysis. Okay? So we'll go ahead, we'll look at the desires and aversions of conium. Okay? Three very important desires you have in conium. To start with, they like salt, they have desire for salt. Okay? And not only salt, they also love coffee. Desires salt, desires coffee, and taste, no, like salt, they have desire for sour things. Puli padartha andre tumba ishta, salt, coffee, and sour. Three very important desires you have in conium. Now, what conium has an aversion to? What conium does not like? Conium basically has an aversion to bread. Bread is something they will not like. See, the desires and aversions are individualistic. I hope as a third year budding homeopath, you understand. Each of you have your own desires and your own aversions. So if it is a conium person will not like coffee, will not like salt. Sorry, will like coffee, will have desire for salt and will have desire for sour. One thing that conium has an aversion will be, he will have an aversion to bread. Very important. Now slowly we'll talk of more important things in conium. And I have tried to show you the image of urinary bladder. Now quickly, tell me what could be the action of conium on the bladder. I feel you can go back to the sphere of action, think and try answering what could be the action of conium on beautiful. The answers are very quick. I like this. Beautiful. Good. Yeah, very good. Somebody says paralysis. Yes, paralytic weakness. Beautiful. I can't take the names because there are so many who have answered, given the right answer. Beautiful. Very good. See, now conium, to start with, is a remedy which mainly causes paralysis. We know that. So what it does is, physiologically, it affects the sphincters and the sphincters go into paralysis. So now what happens when the sphincter muscles, they go into paralysis? You either have a difficulty in voiding urine. So that's how the urine gets accumulated in the bladder and then there can be difficulty in voiding urine. Or, as many of you have rightly written in the chat box, there can be dribbling. There can be dribbling of urine. There can be incontinence of urine. Absolutely right. These are few things that we expect. I'm happy you are following the class and you are interacting. It's a very positive sign for a teacher. It's a good thing. I'm happy. So, on the bladder, as you have rightly told, it can cause paralysis. It can cause difficulty in voiding. See now, as the sphincter muscles go into a paralytic state, now the person has to strain a lot. Okay. So, strains to expel the urine and there can be intermittent flow of urine. There can be dribbling of urine in old men. To start with, I told you, conium is one remedy that generally gets indicated in old men, especially old bachelors. Okay. So, any urinary pathology, okay, in old bachelors, one common remedy that you should think of is conium. Okay. Now, now this is again a very interesting area. Now again, I'll keep this area open for you. Meaning, on the male genitalia, please use your discretion, use your common sense. What could be the probable action of conium on the male genitalia? Purposely, I've got the anatomy picture so that you use your common sense and you can start giving your interpretation. What could be the probable action of conium on male genitalia? Beautiful. Okay. Yes. Yeah. I'm happy. Lot of things. But yes, I go with all what you have tried to tell me. But what I want you to understand, yes, say somebody talks of prostate, somebody is talking of testis, somebody is talking of sexual desire, somebody is talking of impotency. Very good. Absolutely right. This is what I wanted. See, now my explanation, yeah, impotence, absolutely right. See, my explanation for you under the male genitalia is, I'll be dividing my explanation under two very important headings. One is the glandular affections of the conium. We will be using that information and we will see how we can apply that information here, one. And from the ailments, you also know that conium is a person who has got increased sexual desire. So our understanding of conium on the male genitalia will be focused on two areas, one on the glands, and from your anatomy, from the knowledge of your anatomy, you know that the gland that you can expect here is basically the testicles. Okay, so what is the action of conium on testicles will become our primary area, primary focus, and second focus will be on the sexual sphere. Okay, so the primary area will be the glands, will be the testicles. Now you tell me, what could be the probable affections of conium on testicles? What can it cause? You know, conium is a glandular remedy. Yes, very good. Somebody says enlargement. Somebody says swelling. Very good. Somebody says induration. Yes, good, good, good. It causes hardness. See, now to start with, you know, in a very systematic way, what you see is it can cause inflammation. We'll go from your pathological terms. We'll try to apply your knowledge of pathology here. Yeah, somebody has put a question mark. See, good, I'm happy. See, at least what I'm liking with you students is you are applying your mind. Good job, keep it up. Whatever answers you have told, they're all there. I put it in a very systematic way. Fine? You know, good job. Now, on the testicles, what you see is, this is a remedy which can give rise to inflammation. Arthritis. Yes, absolutely right. Pavan says arthritis. Good. So, chronic arthritis, conium is a very important remedy. So, now naturally, when there is chronic inflammation, what happens? There will be pain, there will be swelling, there will be induration. So, all these things, all these signs and symptoms of inflammation will come there. Pain, swelling, etc., etc. So, inflammation is one very important pathology that you have in the conium. Second thing is, you'll also have induration. The inflamed testicles can become hard. Okay? And going back to conium, acting on the glands, it will cause atrophy. So the testicular size can shrink. Okay? See, these are all very important. And we have very few remedies which can cause testicular atrophy. And I would like to share from my practical experience, iodum, plumbum are two very important remedies that I have used for ovarian atrophy, for testicular atrophy with very good results. So please do add plumbum and iodum. When we do plumbum, when we take up iodum, I'll try to give more indications. One of your friend commented, question mark, cancer. Yes, absolutely right. Conium is a cancerous remedy. And I want you to understand the depth of conium. See, conium can get indicated in as simple as inflammation or in as serious as cancerous affections of testis. But mind you, Conium will have its own indications. We'll take up cancerous affections as a separate heading so that you get more clarity. Fine. Okay. So we'll go ahead. The first area, as we wanted to do, the testicles, the glandular affections, and you saw systematically what will happen in conium. Okay. Next, we'll move ahead. We'll talk of this very important area in conium, that is the sexual sphere. Now, quickly from your side, what can conium cause acting on the sexual sphere? We have discussed this a little while ago. In the last class, we have discussed this. Now, try applying that knowledge here, and what could be the probable things that you see? Naveen, yeah, I mean Sunaina, Naveen, Praveen, a lot of people, they have come up with the right answer. So there can be sexual excess, you know, on the male genitalia. It can increase sexual excess. The sexual energy in conium is too much. Okay, so sexual excess, one thing. Only sexual excess. In the mind, we also saw that conium is sexual minded person. His talk, his eye, his gestures will always seek sexual gratification. Okay, so yeah, lasciviousness, though it was a mind symptom. So sexual excess is one thing. For example, when the sexual, yes, absolutely, Siddhik has come with the right point. When the sexual energy does not get an outlet, when the sexual energy gets suppressed, many of the conium problems will start. For example, they can have prostate problems, they can have prostate cancer, they can have testicular problems. When there is no proper outlet for their sexual desire. Okay, fine. So that's why we brought in old bachelors, old widowers. He was sexually very active, wife dies, and then, you know, he slowly develops prostate cancer. Please mind you, this is the statement you'll have to remember. Remember the same words. This is how a patient tomorrow gets into your clinic. Fine. Old man suffers with cancer. See the cancer. It is the genitourinary organs that they go into cancer. Fine. For example, prostate cancer. For example, testicular cancer. And you see in the background, there was a sexual suppression. Your remedy, the first remedy should be conium. Don't forget, a beautiful clinical tip for you today is cancerous affections of prostate, of testicles, which come after sexual suppression, is conium. One more thing you have missed in conium. I have a gentleman, I'll just share a small case with you here. I have a gentleman aged around 55 years, okay? And you know, in the end of the case taking, we got something very interesting. 55-year-old man, even today, he masturbates thrice a day. I repeat, thrice a day, he masturbates. Initially, you know, when he gave this statement, I also could not digest. I thought, what? No, sir. And, you know, he was very happy to tell me that he started masturbating very early, very engaged. When 10th standard, 11th, I mean, 10th year or 11th year, he started masturbating. In spite of having intercourse with his wife, he has to masturbate thrice a day. Now, we also saw one very important ailment in conium, and what was that? Masturbation. So, people who have a disposition, that inheritance, you know, I mean, that's something that is inborn, and they come to you, and see, the dispositions can be various. The disposition in conium related to the sexual area is more of masturbation. So, disposition for masturbation is again conium. On this platform, we will not discuss if it is good, bad, and all those things. But I want you to understand that conium has disposition to masturbation. Okay? There are better remedies than conium. To name few, I'll start with a rare remedy. Oregano, okay, especially in women, especially in children, they have this tendency to masturbate, that is oregano. Don't forget this. Hyoscyamus, again in children. Platina, more in women. We also have Lachesis, We also have sulfur. We have got plenty of remedies. Yes, beautiful. Manjunath contributes Bufo. If you remember my class of Bufo, I told you. Now, what is the PQRS in Bufo? What is the PQRS in Bufo? Yes, somebody? Yeah, IOS, right, agreed. We discussed IOS. I'm asking you a question. What is the PQRS of masturbation in Bufo? Bufo again. Wants to be alone to masturbate. Aisha, very good. Desires solitude to masturbate. And I also told you when I did Bufo, see, masturbation is not a public affair. Fine? And who are the people who masturbate publicly? Don't give me names, I want the remedy. Very good, Naveen, absolutely right. Hyoscyamus, very good. Hyoscyamus, we'll be talking of hyoscyamus probably in the next few classes. Hyoscyamus is again a remedy, a very shameless remedy, who can masturbate in public. But Bufo, see the beauty of Bufo. Yes, Salman has a point here. Mentally, he is very retarded. But what is that area that is very well developed in Bufo is the sexual sphere. Mentally dwarfed and physically overgrown is Bufo. Small head and a large body. Toad. I gave you beautiful examples when I did Bufo in the class. So small head and a large body is Bufo. Yes? Playing with genitals. Okay, agreed. Good. So there are a lot of remedies which have this tendency to masturbate. Conium also should come to your list of those remedies who have the tendency to masturbate. Increased sexual desire, I told you, always his mind is full of sexual thoughts. Okay. And over a period of time, what you also see in Bufo is, this particular remedy, conium, over a period of time, they can go into impotency. So increased sexual desire, complaints which comes from sexual suppression, especially in old people, complaints which comes from celibacy, sexual minded person is the mind of, I mean, is the symptoms you have in male genitalia of, conium. Similarly, it was a very good interaction from your side. Similarly, what do you expect in the female genitalia of conium? I'll give you a small clue. I have the diagram here. So please think which are all the target provinces, dysmenorrhea, something beyond dysmenorrhea. Look at the target organs. Look at the target organs and then start contributing. Sunaina Spurti says ovaries, very good. See, ovaries, yes, now that you know that clue. Testicles, there was atrophy. So you're using your common sense. And you are trying to tell me, sir, ovaries, there can be inflammation or there can be atrophy. Very good. So, the ovaries or the uterus can go into this pathology, that is induration. Okay. So, induration, very good. Manjunath, Salman, they have their own things to contribute. Yes. So, induration is one very important thing I wanted to add here. And there can be growths. For example, you have fibroid. Fibroid in a lady who is sexually not happy, there can be fibroid. There can be uterine affections. Ovarian cyst comes up in a lady who is not sexually satisfied. For me, a better remedy when there is ovarian cyst from sexual suppression will be Apis mellifica. Don't forget Apis, a very important remedy. Ovarian cyst which develops from sexual suppression is Apis. And many of you in the chat box have contributed a lot to do with menses. So what is that menstrual irregularities that you expect in conium? Somebody has told amenorrhea, I agree with you. Somebody has told dysmenorrhea, could be. Now, talking about amenorrhea, what brings on amenorrhea in conium? There are a lot of remedies having amenorrhea and they have their own reasons. Okay? Say, I mean, somebody says they have raised their hand, I don't know what exactly it is. So if you have any questions, please feel free to type in the chat box so that we can have a better interaction. So talking about the menstrual irregularities that we have in conium, many of you have given me the right answer. Dipping their hand in cold water or exposure to cold can give rise to amenorrhea in conium. These are all physiological causes. If you look at pathological causes, ovarian atrophy or cysts in ovary can again give rise to amenorrhea in conium. Dysmenorrhea, scanty menses, painful menses, prolonged menses can also come up in conium. Okay. So one last area I want to talk about in conium is the sexual area in female. So you can have nymphomania or complaints which comes from sexual suppression. Okay. I have many cases where we have cured, we could help them homeopathically, you know, with conium when there is sexual suppressions and they come out with some symptoms. And see, even I was surprised how conium can so beautifully take care. You know, sexual suppression, you give conium and you see a lot of changes in the condition that the patient is suffering with. Okay. So you can also think of fibroid, uterine fibroid, and this is very important. Conium has an affinity for growth. So similarly, here in the breast, what is that growth that you can expect here is, you can either expect fibroadenoma, a benign tumor, or you can expect a malignant tumor also. Malignancy, I'll talk in the next slide. Here, we'll focus on fibroadenoma. Okay, so lady feels, observes that there are small knots, there are small growth in her breast, okay, and they are painful before menses, and the pains are better by pressing her hand against the breast. So this is the characteristic amelioration that you have in conium. Now, one small remedy that comes up here is bryonia. We'll have a small comparison. One remedy is bryonia. You all know bryonia. So bryonia again has heaviness of breast. They also feel better by pressing the breast with the hand. So heart pressure ameliorates in bryonia. So conium, bray is also a glandular remedy. So female, to sum up, what we have in bryonia, what we have in conium is, it can cause growth, it can cause cysts, it can cause atrophy, it can cause cancer, it can cause menstrual irregularities, it can cause fibroid, it can also affect the breast, the accessory sexual organ. One more area, apart from the genitalia, that becomes very important for us in conium is the respiratory affections. Quickly, what we have in conium respiratory is that there is a dry cough. This dry cough in conium mainly comes from a tickling sensation. There is a tickling sensation in the throat, and then you see they coughing. Any remedies that you can think of quickly? I have not explored this area in conium because, you know, sometimes we get prejudiced from our practice. And many times I have had beautiful results with Rumex. You'll be studying Rumex in the next class, next year, final year. Rumex is a beautiful remedy. It has its own small totality. So when they have tickling in the throat, night aggravation, gets exposed to cold, they have cough, we have used Rumex, beautiful remedy. But conium has tickling sensation or a dry spot in the larynx which brings on cough, dry cough. Now what again becomes very important for you is, the cough in conium is more at night, the cough is more on lying down. Now this will force the person to sit up. This is very important. He is not able to lie down, tickling sensation in larynx, brings on cough, and is forced to sit up. If you have this mal totality, please think of cornea. Okay, very important. If you see the text here, the same thing I have written here, and I have highlighted in red that they have to sit up. This is very, very important. Okay, talking, laughing, or turning in the bed can bring on cough, and they have to immediately sit up. Very, very characteristic of cornea. Okay, now hemlock, poison hemlock, and this is what we started with. Acting on the CNS, conium causes paralysis. Can somebody quickly tell me the character of paralysis in conium? What was the character of paralysis? Very good, Bhavya, absolutely fine. Yeah, lot of people, Gautami, Bhavya, good. Now what I wanted you to understand is, not all cases of paralysis conium will get indicated. See, now this is something that I keep telling you repeatedly. We don't have specifics in homeopathy. Any case of paralysis, we can't treat conium. Conium can treat those cases of paralysis which belong to conium. Meaning, it should be ascending type of paralysis. Okay, so there conium gets better indicated. Okay, so I'll just give you a few indications of conium in paralysis. Paralysis, which mainly comes from injury to the spine. Concussion, or a person meets with an accident or his spine gets injured and then he goes into paralysis. We have four remedies in our homeopathic materia medica. Very simple. One is arnica, the other one is hypericum, and the other one is conium. Okay, so your search becomes very easy. And if it is conium, it will be mainly ascending type. You can see and you can start prescribing. So paralysis, ascending paralysis, I repeat, very important and characteristic in conium. GB syndrome, somebody beautifully writes there, GB syndrome, good. So weakness of legs, trembling, jerking of the muscles, ascending paralysis. As a third year student, you should also remember which are all the other remedies. Must be, if we come to final year, we'll talk of differentiating them. At least you should know, it's not only conium. There are few more remedies in our materia medica which can get beautifully indicated for ascending paralysis. Now, which are those? Arsenic, calicarb, you also have vipera, you have plumbum. Plumbum keeps coming up very often, and you also have phosphorus. Okay? So now what did we do before I take up the next interesting part? A small recap of what we tried to understand. I started with eye complaints. Okay? We saw the photophobia, we also saw paralysis, ocular muscles going into paralysis. I spoke to you about the desires and aversions of conium. We quickly spoke of the urogenitalia. This was very important. We spoke of bladder, we spoke of male, we spoke of female. And the last topic we spoke was paralysis. Now, I am trying to tell you about an interesting part of conium, that is cancerous affections of conium. Okay? Now I am just trying to give you which are all the parts that gets affected in conium. If you have to put it in one word, that word that I'll be using is cancer of glands. Okay? Or if you want to be more specific, conium will have cancer of the lips. Cancer of lips. Now what brings on cancer in conium is, like, you know, if you read good books, Kent and other books, they say cancer which comes from the pressure of the pipe. See, this no more is the trend, but if you see our old Bollywood movies or old movies, that was a trend there, using this pipe. Okay, so what is the indication of conium is the pressure of the pipe. The constant irritation of the pipe will disturb the lips, and then it goes into cancer. You saw cancer of breast from blow, blow was also an injury. Similarly, keeping this pipe constantly over a period of year, this can cause a constant irritation and it can give rise to cancer. So cancer from the pipe, and I have been insisting that, you know, conium is a very good remedy for cancer of breast, cancer of uterus, cancer of bladder, especially in old bachelors, cancer of bones, cancer which comes after a blow, okay, cancer of stomach. These are few structures that primarily gets affected in conium, okay, cancerous affections. Now, what are the symptoms of conium? These are all the organs that I've tried to give you. When you have burning pains in the initial stage of cancer, when you have lancinating burning pains, you can think of conium. Okay, I have a few cases of cancer. Must be, you know, very recently we had a case of CS stomach that going into metastasis to the liver, and she had bad vomiting, bad weight loss. She is a lady who doesn't want to undergo chemotherapy, and she is with us for last 3 months. First 2 months we tried with various remedies, nothing helped. And last 1 month, after a right homeopathic remedy, the beauty is there is no more vomiting. She is able to eat. It's too premature for me to talk about this case. Give me some time. Must be 3 months or 6 months. We'll see how the case is progressing, and then I will openly discuss with you. This lady again was not given conium. Why I'm trying to tell you is I want you to understand that not all cases of cancer we give conium. This is what I want you, as a young man, you have to, or as a young lady, you'll have to have this very clear in your mind that, you know, each case of cancer will have its own presentation. So we take up that totality, we match with the right homeopathic medicine, and then we prescribe. I told you first 2 months there was no improvement. Can you understand why there was no improvement in the first 2 months? Because first 2 months I gave a wrong remedy. I made a mistake. I gave a wrong remedy. I did not get the case properly. Now the next month, you know, after retaking the case, now we see improvement. She is gaining weight. Her hemoglobin has gone high by a gram, but it makes a lot of sense. She is increased by 1 kg. That again might be a small improvement, but yes, it makes a lot of sense for me, because I have seen last 2 months how she started losing weight, how her hemoglobin dropped. Okay, so cancer of conium, this is what you need to understand. I'll share that case after some time. Somebody was talking to me about the sweating of conium when I asked them about the eye complaints. Very nice, but I did not comment there because I wanted to comment here, because conium is a remedy which has sweating on closing eyes. Now quickly, what was more when opening eyes, something used to aggravate in conium. What used to aggravate in conium? Vertigo aggravation. Yes, very good. Vertigo aggravation, opening eyes, closing eyes, correct? Here, on closing eyes, they start getting sweating. So on closing eyes, vertigo, they felt better, but on closing eyes, they will have sweating, very profuse sweating. The other remedies are Lachesis, Bryonia, Calcarea, Pulse and Graphite. Okay. Now the last area of conium is the modalities. We have 5 minutes time. We'll try to finish this. Lying down aggravates, you know, many of you know, lying down aggravates, turning in the bed. Majority of the complaints in conium aggravates. Being away from sex, they can have a lot of problems. As we see in conium, when they are having sex frequently, their complaints are better. Exposure to cold, taking cold, drinking cold aggravates in conium. Mental stress, emotional stress can aggravate in conium. What ameliorates? Now this is a very important thing I want you to remember. Hanging feet down, letting the feet down, ameliorates in conium. Yes, and pressure ameliorates in conium, movement ameliorates in conium, and conium